Well, hello everyone. This is for I Believe in Science in the Arab World. So with me is Professor Lawrence Krauss. Lawrence Krauss, American theoretical physicist, cosmologist, who is the foundation professor of the School of Earth and Space Exploration at Arizona State University and the director of the Origins Project. He's also the author of several best-selling books, including The Physics of Star Trek and Universe from Nothing. Hello, Professor. Welcome to New York City. I'm Faisal from Iraq, and thanks for doing this interview for
I'm happy to do it. It sounds like a wonderful sight.
Yeah, it is. So let's go quickly to the comments section. So you said in your book, A Universe from Nothing, I quote, "The stars died so you could be born." Can you explain how can we be made of star stuff?
Well, we are. That's one of the most poetic things in all of science. It turns out that the elements that make you and I up, most of the elements, the carbon, the nitrogen, the oxygen, all of those weren't created in the Big Bang. We can show, in fact, that in the Big Bang, the only elements that were created in the first few minutes of the universe were hydrogen, protons, and the next lightest element, helium, and a little teeny bit of lithium. And when we make predictions about how much of those elements should be produced, it agrees exactly with the observations, so we know the Big Bang really happened. But that's not the stuff that makes you and I up. The stuff that really matters is the carbon, the nitrogen, and the iron, and the oxygen. All of those things are only created in the nuclear furnaces inside of stars. The nuclear reactions that power stars produce those heavier elements. But the only way they can get into your body, my body, and therefore, if the stars are kind enough to explode, and once every 100 years per galaxy, a star explodes, and it expels all the materials that have been produced during its lifetime into the cosmos. You create other stars and other solar systems, and in fact, therefore, the atoms in your body and my body have each experienced the most violent explosion in the universe, a supernova explosion. Not just one, but maybe many, and the atoms in your left hand could have come from stars, different stars in your right hand. So you literally are stardust, and if stars hadn't exploded, we couldn't be here. And who knows, maybe the atoms that make us up were once part of a planet near a star that exploded that maybe had life on it. Maybe someone was doing an interview on the same subject millions of years ago.
That would be great. Wow. So, in your book also, the question is, why is there something rather than nothing? How can we know that we live in a flat universe that popped out of nothing?
Well, we don't know we popped out of nothing. What we can show is that it's completely plausible and the laws of physics allow it. And out of nothing, you can create a universe with 100 billion galaxies, each containing 100 billion stars. And you don't require any supernatural shenanigans. The laws of physics allow it. It doesn't violate any known laws of physics. Now, as far as knowing the universe is flat, that we can do by measuring it, the same way as we can measure whether that piece of paper is flat. If the piece of paper is flat, you draw a triangle on it, it adds up to 180 degrees. Now, when I say flat, I don't mean flat like a pancake. I mean flat in a three-dimensional sense. We live in a curved three-dimensional universe, but the rules are still the same. If we draw a big enough triangle in our universe and measure its angles, we can see if the universe is curved on large scales. And what we've been able to do with our observational techniques using the cosmic microwave background and other things is to actually measure a large enough triangle and find out that indeed the universe is flat. So we live in the universe you always thought you lived in, where the X, Y, and Z axes point to the same direction throughout all of space. And a flat universe is kind of the universe we would have predicted if we got most of what we have here from nothing. And so the bottom line is that we can't prove the universe we live in spontaneously came from nothing. But if you ask what would be the characteristics of a universe that was created from nothing by known laws of physics, they'd be more or less precisely the characteristics of the universe we see.
Wow, that's incredible. The question number three, what is your favorite explanation for the end of our universe?
Well, I don't know whether favorite or not. I'm not sure I try and deal with favorites. It turns out that it looks like the universe will end with a whimper and not a bang. If the expansion of the universe nowadays is extrapolated into the future, which may not be appropriate and we don't know yet, but if you just take the most naive extrapolation of what we see, where the universe is expanding ever faster and faster, all the rest of the universe will disappear. Distant galaxies will one day be moving away from us faster than light. The universe will become cold and dark and empty, and that's the future. So So enjoy it while you can.
That's a great lesson. So this question is mostly for young people. Who was your favorite scientist or your idol when you were a college student?
Well, I think one of my favorite scientists, and I wrote a book about him, is Richard Feynman. Obviously, Albert Einstein was someone we all admired and all the rest, but Richard Feynman was very charismatic and really expressed a joy of physics and loved explaining it. And I guess I thought of him as a role model in some ways. I knew him. But he was a wonderful physicist and a brave scientist, and he conveyed the excitement and joy of discovery. And for me, that was very important. And I think when I try and write and speak, now I'm privileged to be in a position now to be able to do some of the things he did then for me.
He wrote a book about the subject about like how wonderful science is as far as I know.
Oh, he wrote a lot of books, mostly autobiographical books, but he wrote some really good books about science, also short ones. He wrote a great series of lecture notes that all physics students have called the Feynman Lectures. But there was one very small volume which is based on some lectures he gave which were which were filmed, called The Character of Physical Law. And I read that when I was in high school, and that made a big impact on me.
Okay, great. Can you tell us more about the Origins Project?
Well, the Origins Project at Arizona State University is a very exciting program. I moved to Oregon State to direct it. We look at everything from the origins of the universe to the origins of consciousness, the origins of early modern humans, meeting recently on the origins of violence. Basically, at the forefront of every area of research, origins questions are important. And what we try and do is bring the best people in the world from a wide variety of fields to come and look at those questions to see if we can make progress. So we have a research meeting with people from lots of different areas who don't often normally talk to each other to see if we can make progress. And then we have public events where we have 3,000 people attend among the public, which is unique perhaps in the country, because we bring the best people in the world here and to Arizona State. And all of it is on the web and the archive. You can watch it. And
yeah, I was going to ask you that. So it is available online.
Oh yeah, origins.asu.edu. Yeah, it's, and hundreds of thousands of people watch our events, and you should all watch it.
Great. So while we're doing the project for doing this for I Believe in Science, so what do you think the efforts that I Believe in Science is doing for the Arabic-speaking world?
Well, I think it's very, very important that in the Arab-speaking world, but in the whole world, what's going to determine the difference between the countries that are thriving and the countries that aren't are a skilled workforce that can appreciate the revolutions taking place in science, not just in the abstract areas I talk about, but biotechnology, computer technology, energy, all of these areas. And it's really important that people in the Arab world have a training and are exposed to this. I know there's some people who would rather that people don't know anything about science for fear that it will somehow take away their religious beliefs. But that's doing a disservice to children. They need to be exposed to the cutting edge ideas and be excited, because only then will the Arab world be able to develop a skilled workforce and researchers who can help the countries thrive economically. So it's happening in Asia, it's happening elsewhere. People realize that if you want to become one of the haves rather than the have-nots, you need to be able to educate your people. And it's the best thing we can do for our children, is to expose them to the wonders of nature. So I'm very happy to be part of this so that this project can continue to do that.
I'm sure many people are happy too. Like in the Arab world, you've been a fan of many people I know. So, I mean, the last question is, what is your advice for the Arab youth? I mean, well, you gotta be watched by tens of thousands from the Arab world.
My advice to all youths is don't let the bastards get you down. Namely, it's not just Arab youth, but all youth. Follow your dreams. Don't lose your sense of excitement. Always be prepared to be surprised, and open your mind to surprises, and the world will be a better place, and your life will be more fulfilling. That's all I can say.
That's great. Well, thank you all for listening, and
thanks again. Klaus,
thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. No problem. Thank you. I Believe in Science.